Amen. Now, I said that, and I mean it, because I know we got a lot of family. I'm going to do my very best to honor that and get y'all out of here in time for supper. Amen. I know, 2 Corinthians. Didn't I say 5:15? Okay. Let's read together. It's on the board if you don't have it. 2 Corinthians 5. Let's begin. I'm going to really focus on verse 15. Maybe read a little bit longer. Starting in verse 14. For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and rose again. Jesus did all that he did for your sake. Everybody say, for my sake. Think about that. Let's say that one more time. Thinking now what Jesus did and how he died. Let's say it again. He did it for my sake. Now, whether you know it or not, you needed it. You say, well, I'm a pretty good old fellow, Pastor Randy. Maybe you haven't met me before. I mean, I'm a really good fella, really good lady. I mean, but I want to tell you something. Everybody was born in sin. Every human being has a sin nature. I got in trouble a few weeks ago when Lucy was born by telling everybody how evil she was. Now, that's about a year ago. Now, I wasn't prophesying, but, you know, begin to see some things take place. Amen? Called rebellion. Called, I don't want to mind. Called this and the other. It's the sin nature. It doesn't mean she's a rotten, no good. But every child is born with that demonic nature. You don't have to teach a kid to lie, do you? You got to teach them to steal. You got to teach them to be mean. You got to teach them to bite. You got to teach them to claw. I mean, none of my kids ever did that, or my grandkids. They never did none of that. But they're born with that Adamic nature to do wrong. That's why you needed a Savior. I don't care how good you are, amen, how morally good, you may not have never cussed, drink, smoke, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, whatever sin you want to name. But you were rotten to the core. Listen to me. Everybody is born rotten, evil at the core. That's why Jesus said, you must be born again. He wasn't talking to a select few. He was talking to everybody. Everybody say must. You must be born again. And if you're not born again, you will die and go to hell. I know this is a resurrection Easter Sunday, but I want to tell you the truth this morning. Because I love you. You must be born again. And that's why he died. That's why he rose. He said, for their sake, he died and was raised. I even got me a little order of service up here. Now, if you're new, we never have this before. So I don't know what all this means. It has order of service at the top there. And, I mean, we are orderly, but normally we are fluid, spirit-led. That's not the word. We are spirit-led, but, I mean, people got a word. People got a scripture. People got a song. You know, we do like to be flexible. That's still. Anyway, moving right along. We got an order of service to do. Really am trying to stay on. And so I want to tell you, number one, point number one, live for him. This Sunday, this Easter Sunday, I think you're the greatest thing you could ever do, the greatest decision you could ever make. If you hadn't been born again, get born again so you can live with him, live for him, and live with him. But if you're born again, you've been a Christian, it's time to live for Him. Read with me one more time there at the end of verse 15. He died for all that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for Him who for their sakes died and rose. Who are you living for? Let me ask you that very important question. Listen to me. Who are you living for? Now, I know everybody here is thinking, I live for God. I live for God. And I imagine if we probably ask you, and we'd all, that's just kind of automatic answer. Okay. So in the morning, when you get up and you go to work, what does it look like to live for God? How do you know whether you're living for Him or not? And when you come home and your wife, I better not do that. But when you come home and she's, Lord, help me get out of here. But when you have an opportunity to be kind, when you have an opportunity to forgive, when you have an opportunity to do good to those who are not good to you and to love your enemies, this is what living for Him looks like. You know what it looks like? Him. What does it mean to live for Him, Pastor Randy? It means live like Him. You act like Him. You talk like Him. You look like Him. You have the fruit of the Spirit. Amen. You have the power of God. Sin is an exception in your life and not the rule, because we have been delivered from the power of sin. And so we live for Him when we're living like Him and we're living for His glory. Galatians 2:20 says, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. I live, yet not I live. Paul's testimony, I'm crucified with Christ. I've been buried with Him by baptism into His death and raised to walk in newness of life. I have been crucified with Christ. The old man has been crucified. Yes, it has. Consider yourself, the Bible says, dead to sin and alive unto God. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth. Living for Him. Living for Him. If we live, Romans 14:7-9, if we live, it's to honor the Lord. If we die, it's to honor the Lord. So whether we live or whether we die, we belong to the Lord, who for our sake died and rose again. Paul said in Philippians, for me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ. For me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Paul knew what it meant. That's why, for my sake, Jesus died. Jesus rose, because He knew how badly I needed redeemed. He knew how rotten I was to the core. And because He did what He did for my sake, He died for me. I think we need to live for Him. Amen. For me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Secondly, I want to mention, live for Him. Secondly, Romans chapter 7, verse 4. Let's turn there with us. Belong to Him. They say, live for Him. Belong to Him. Romans chapter 7, verse 4. Romans 7:4. Likewise, my brothers, you also have died to the law through the body of Christ, so that you may belong to another, to Him who has been raised from the dead, in order that we may bear fruit for God. See, if we're living for Him, we're bearing fruit for Him. And we belong to Him. Many of your translations, I feel, do a good job of translating, because they use the word married. How many of you in your Bibles use the word married to Him? You understand what that means? Hey, listen to me. When we become united with Christ, let me tell you something. There's a union that takes place There is a connection that takes place. There's a cleaving through that takes place that is supernatural. And you become a part of the body of Christ. And you are married to Him. That's why it's very important to love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. Be ye separate, saith the Lord, because you are married to the Son of God. You understand that? It's not just a, hey, I'm going to go to God so I can count on my life. I need a job. I need a wife. I need a husband. Maybe I don't need this wife. No, I'm kidding. So I'm going to go to God because He wants to help me. No. You don't go to your wife for that reason, and you don't go to Jesus for that reason. I come to my wife when I met Elizabeth on a blind date. Woo! I said, Lord, on a blind date. And I knew when I saw her, Stu, she was mine. Now, for 3 months, for 3 months, she ran. I mean, she ran fast and she ran hard. I sent her flowers. I sent her love notes. I stopped by the school, Tyler, just to tell her, how you doing? You know, drive out of my way, do a lot of things just to let her know I love her. And she didn't give me the time of day, Dan. I don't mean the time. She didn't care. In fact, she told her mother, I can't stand him. That's how much she needed the Lord right there. Really bad. Really bad. He really needed redemption. But when I asked her to marry me, I'm going to make this point loud and clear. When I asked her to marry, it wasn't for what she could do for me. That's selfish. When we come to God, when it's all about, I got to come to God because He'll fix this, He'll fix this, He'll fix this, He'll do it. No, I come to Elizabeth because I love you. And I want to be united, joined together with you. Because I love you. I dedicate myself to you and none other. See what it'd be like in the morning. How many of you would think it would be a little bit out of order for me to go out with another woman tomorrow? A little bit. That would be deadly. That would be deadly, I promise. So in the morning, Tuesday morning, who are you going out with? It's your commitment to Him every day, 24/7. That means you ain't going to be in the bar drinking Friday night. That means you're going out. You're two-timing. You have been married. This scripture, it became so strong in me this week. You belong to another. 1 Corinthians 6, verse 16. Can we look there real quick? He did it for our sake. He deserves our wholehearted, our consecration to Him, our dedication to Him. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16, 17, and we'll read a couple of more later. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 16. Or do you not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her? See, there's a union going on. That's why sex is holy. That's why sex is more holy than it is natural. That's why God kept it and ordained it for marriage. Because it is more, 50,000 million times more than a physical act. It's a union. And it's a belonging to. And when you do that, you become part of that person. Forever and ever. And ever. Verse 16. Do not know that he who is joined to a prostitute becomes one body with her. For as it is written, the two will become one flesh. But he who is joined to the Lord. Woo! Joined to the Lord. Becomes one spirit with him. It's more than just a coming down the aisle. It's a union that takes place. I say, Father, it's a marriage that takes place. We are the bride of Christ, His church, united with Him. One mind, one body, one spirit, joined by one spirit. Look over there in verse 19, there in 1 Corinthians 6, down to verse 19. Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own. Belong to Him. Belong to Him. You are not your own. For you have been bought with a price. So glorify God in your mind and in your body. They are the Lord's. Live for Him. Belong to Him. And lastly, Romans chapter 6, verse 4. Isn't God good? Oh, He did it for our sake. And I'm so thankful. Romans 6, 4. We were buried with Him by baptism into His death. In order that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Newness of life. I love that word. It doesn't mean you're going to get any younger. I'm sorry. You come to Jesus today, you're going to be the same old. No, I'm kidding. Your numerical age is not going to change, but your freshness of your life will change. I'm talking, I love fresh. I like to wash clothes and just get them out of the dryer. Don't they just smell fresh? You put them in there and they're, whoo, stinky. You know, no, none of y'all are like that, but ours stink. You know, and you put them in there, they're musty. They've been in a dirty clothes hamper and there's wet towels and all that. Pull them out. Oh, it stinks, Jim. It stinks. Just like we do without God. Now, you may think you're beautiful and smell good, but see, Jesus looks on the heart. Jesus looks on the heart. And I love every one of you, but without Christ, you're corrupt. You know what corrupt means? I failed to empty a dish from the kitchen. I did it yesterday, but it had been there a couple of days. 3 days? I'm cheating a little. Anyway, when I took it out, it begun to stunk. It has stunk. And I won't say really, we don't think that. But I'm going to tell you, your life stinks without Jesus. I mean, I love you. But your life, here's the key. Jesus wants to give you freshness. See, 1 Corinthians 5, 17, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things become fresh. Some of you in this room need a freshness. Stale. And people's lives are marked by staleness, just corruptness, you just need to trade a rotten life. A life that's spoiled and stinks, and you need to be washed and you need to be cleansed in the precious blood of the Lamb. He died for our sake. Tired of the old? There's a fresh. There's a new from Jesus. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1. Scripture says, you hath He quickened, who were dead in your trespasses and sins. Quicken there. You made alive. He's made you alive. You see, before Christ, even though you're breathing, spiritually you are dead. That's why you stink. The analogy. I don't mean you literally. Don't be running around and say, oh, that's Easter Sunday, man. I went to church. Just pastor told me I sunk. Got up and went all that, got some major trouble and went to Easter service, and the preacher just stood up there and told me I stink. But I really, you don't stink. You don't really don't stink. I want to ask you to examine your heart. And I believe because he did what he did, boy, it behooves us to live for him. We can do that. Second, because we belong to him, united together with him. Then, because we are linked up with him and living for him, belonging to him, we can be like him in a whole new, fresh way. Buried with him by baptism into his death. Raised to walk in newness. Everybody say newness. Experiencing a life of the power and the presence of God. I appreciate what Daniel said earlier. Boy, I tell you, and I remember that day, 1973, in Red Oak, Texas, when I nailed on my knee. Pastor Sam Walker laid his hands on my head, and a freshness, an outpouring of the Spirit came on me like never before. And I spoke in tongues, and I laughed, and I'm telling you, there is nothing. Let me emphasize to you, there is nothing that compares to the new creature. Nothing. Man, living water bubbling forth. Newness of life. No more stale breath. No more dull life. I'm talking about, I am come, Jesus said, that you might have life and have it in abundance. If you live for him, you belong to him, and you act like him, you will experience an amazing, abundant life. Let's pray. Let's pray. Just quietly before the Lord, as you bow your head this morning.